From the dawn of his existence, man looked up with envy at the birds. He longed to rise in the sky and sail effortlessly on the wings of the wind. Flight was his age-old dream, yet throughout all history, the greatest scientific thinkers considered flight to be totally impossible. Man remained bound to the earth. Is a flying machine. Its form was conceived entirely in the mind of man. He constructed it with his hands from metals, ceramics, and fossil fuels he extracted from the earth. It's an amazing device, for it rides at tremendous speeds on the infinite highway of the air. Yet for thousands of years, its principles eluded the most penetrating mind. Then, dramatically, around the turn of this century, a miracle occurred. Two young men from Middle America, working together in synergistic unison, unlocked the secrets of flight. It was perhaps the greatest success in the human experience.
I'm Harry Combs. The story of Orville and Wilbur Wright is perhaps one of our greatest national treasures, yet few of us know very much about it. I personally wandered through half a century of aviation activity with a mistaken belief that I knew the story of the Wright brothers, when in fact I knew surprisingly little about the tremendous accomplishments of these remarkable men.
We've all heard of the Wrights, but most of us think of them as two boys from Dayton, Ohio, who ran a bicycle shop and began tinkering with flying machines. We had the impression that by balancing this and tuning up that, they finally staggered into the air in 1903. Nothing could be further from the truth. The fact is that these two self-taught brothers were first-class scientists in their own right. The brothers were a perfect team. Their interacting minds produced a combined intelligence which was the equal of the greatest minds in history. Although they had no formal education in engineering, they arrived at the successful development of an airplane by a complicated series of abstract ideas whose very nature challenged the best scientific brains. But these two talented men were not only brilliant in theory, they were also great constructors. They were doers with dreams. If one wished to fly, the obvious thing would be to emulate the birds. The Wrights, with their eyes of genius, quickly saw that there were two kinds of bird flight: fast wing flapping and rigid wing soaring. Although the brothers instinctively understood how flapping birds sustained themselves in flight, they perceived it would be an engineering nightmare to construct a mechanism to imitate them. On the other hand, they knew they could probably construct a rigid-winged apparatus to imitate the soaring birds if they could just understand how they sustained and controlled themselves in the air. When it came to sustaining lift, the Wrights saw that nature, the best engineer, had given the birds curved wings with thick leading edges. Indeed, tests showed that curved surfaces delivered far more lift than flat surfaces when presented at an angle to the wind. But why?
Later, aeronautical engineers determined that air passing over a curved wing traveled faster than air passing under it.
This increase in velocity on the top caused a reduction in pressure, resulting in lift. The Wrights' next step was to properly design a light but rigid structure sufficient to sustain a man's weight. They turned to the concepts of Octave Chanute, a French-born American engineer who had experimented with aerodynamic designs. The brothers selected Chanute's method of biplane construction because of its rigidity and strength. It was patterned along the lines of the Pratt truss, a design used in building railroad bridges. The next crucial step was to devise the means to control this flying machine in the vast three-dimensional ocean of the air. The boys looked first to Otto Lilienthal, a German scientist who had begun his gliding experiments in 1891. Lilienthal attempted to control his glider by shifting his weight from side to side. But in 1896, he crashed to his death, testifying to the deficiencies of his method. Concerned, the Wright brothers looked again to the birds and observed that they possessed a more dynamic way. They watched the birds twist their wingtips to bank and turn. So they applied this principle to their gliders by warping the wings. In 1899, they verified the validity of all these ideas by building a kite with curved wings, rigid biplane design, and their own system of wing warping. They controlled it from the ground with strings. The wing warping worked beautifully. However, the kite showed an alarming capacity to rise suddenly and dive. The Wrights observed that this equilibrium problem was directly related to lift. They knew that to achieve lift, the wing had to be kept at a proper angle to the wind. They observed, however, that as the kite rose, the angle of the wing would increase. The wing would then create too much resistance to the wind, and rather than lift, it would stall and plunge to the ground. It was because of this problem that Lilienthal died. The Wrights knew that they had to find a solution before attempting to fly. In the front of their glider kite, they placed a small movable wing or horizontal elevator. They would now be able to move this elevator to create a counteracting nose-down pressure when the wing's angle became too great. Conversely, when the glider had a tendency to dive forward, the elevator could be turned to force the nose up. They could now control the glider to keep the wing at the proper angle to the wind for lift. This forward elevator was to become the hallmark of all Wright airplanes. Greatly encouraged, the brothers embarked on a definitive program of scientific investigation. After corresponding with the Weather Bureau, they chose the vicinity of Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, as the best location for gliding experiments. This isolated area provided large sand slopes with steady winds and no obstructions. They came here in 1900, camping at the foot of Big Kill Devil Hill, the largest of a group of sand dunes. For 4 long years, under considerable hardship, they spent most of their summers and falls here, laboring to make man's age-old dream come true. They were now ready for their next great step, manned flight. If you put yourself in the position of an early experimenter, you must realize that you're going to use a man-made wing contraption of fabric and wood for the purpose of gliding down the slope of a hill. You have to imagine a condition in which you decide to launch yourself and trust your whole body weight to some kind of structure which rides on nothing but air, invisible, and at that time, totally unknown air. In other words, you might well ask, how strong is the wind that passes across my wings? Is this air pressure strong enough to support me? This the Wrights had to know. The manner in which the brothers went about correctly predicting the strength and support of air pressure was a magnificent feat and typical of their intellectual capacity. The Wrights designed their glider based upon the same universally accepted formulas for lift and drag used by Lilienthal and others. Using these formulas, the Wrights expected to calculate the correct relationship between the velocity of the wind, the size of the wing surface against which the wind would strike, and the pressure or force which would result. In other words, with these formulas, they should be able to determine the amount of weight a glider of any given size would carry in a wind of measurable velocity. When the Wrights first tested their 1900 glider, the machine, to their great disappointment, produced only one half the expected lift, carrying 75 pounds and not the 150-pound man for which it was designed. Obviously, they would have to build a larger glider if they expected a successful man carrier. Consequently, in 1901, they recalculated their design and increased the wing area from 165 to 290 square feet. Still, the glider did not perform as well as expected. They began to suspect significant errors in their calculations. To understand the problem, it should first be noted that all calculations for lift and drag were made using the so-called Smeaton factor, a mathematical value named for John Smeaton, an Englishman who in 1759 had compiled a table of wind pressures based on experiments with water-lifting Dutch windmills. Through his experiments, Smeaton had determined that if you multiplied the square of the wind's velocity by 0.005, you'd get the pressure in pounds per square inch exerted on any flat surface placed at right angles to the wind. This factor was later altered by Lilienthal to 0.0055. As a result of their experiments, the brothers concluded that Lilienthal's calculations were seriously in error. The Wrights returned home that year in a state of deep despair. If the work of the early experimenters like Smeaton and Lilienthal was in error, where were they to start again? The problems just seemed too great, too complex, and perhaps insoluble. Wilbur told Orville it would be 1,000 years before man would fly. But now, fate took a hand. In September of 1901, Octave Chanute, impressed by the brothers' work, invited Wilbur to address the prestigious Western Society of Engineers in Chicago. Wilbur first declined the invitation. The brothers weren't sure it would be appropriate for two bicycle mechanics from Dayton to discuss their findings before such an august group of engineers. Their sister Catherine, however, always a great source of support, urged Wilbur to accept. She believed that her brothers were on the threshold of making a great contribution. She wrote her father, Bishop Milton Wright, that she nagged Will into going. As a result, Wilbur delivered a paper that even today is recognized as one of the most definitive expressions of aerodynamic theory ever written. Encouraged by this success, Wilbur and Orville enthusiastically continued their quest.
By this time, the brothers were convinced that they'd based much of their early work on data incorrectly compiled by others.
The brothers knew that there were two factors that had to be considered in attaining lift. One was the determination of the most efficient wing curve. The other was the measurement of air pressure, or the strength of the wind at any given velocity. To determine the first factor, the best wing curve, they fashioned small strips of metal in various shapes to simulate wing forms or airfoils. They then needed a way to test and compare the performance of these different shapes in a wind of constant velocity. At first, they mounted these on a sort of weather vane, balanced against a flat surface of measured size and exposed to the wind. But the outdoor wind proved to be variable and unreliable. Next, they tried fastening the shapes on the rim of a bicycle wheel, mounted flat on one of their bicycles, which they would pedal at specific speeds. But even this arrangement was subject to error. The boys' next idea was the foundation of all aircraft design. They constructed a wind tunnel. It was 6 feet long, 16 inches square. A small gasoline engine drove the wind fan, and wind straighteners kept the airflow smooth. Once they began their experiments, they demanded precision, moving nothing in the room and always standing in the same place. The Wrights could now take precise measurements as they observed the action of each airfoil through the glass window on top of the tunnel. In 2 months, the brothers tested over 200 different wing configurations. By this means, they were able to pick the best wing curve. To solve the second factor, air pressure or strength of the wind, they engaged in a series of theoretical calculations of their own. The formulas which the brothers had used in the design of their 1900 and 1901 gliders contain, among other elements, measurements for the area of their wing and for the velocity of the wind. But most important of all, they contained a value for the support of the air, or the coefficient of air pressure, the strength of the wind.
Previously stated incorrectly by Lilienthal, this was now the unknown in their equation.
To find this unknown value, they took their 1901 glider apart and flew each wing separately as a kite, measuring the pounds of resistance or drag on a spring scale. The brothers then entered these measurements into the drag equation, and after transposing and solving, arrived at a new value for K, 0.0033, a little more than half of Lilienthal's value of 0.0055.
Now, for the first time, there emerged a body of aeronautical knowledge that was truly exact, and without which it was totally impossible to design a successful airplane.
What's more, the Wright's figure of 0.0033 was amazingly precise, incredibly close to the value of 0.003289 our engineers use today in designing modern jets.
This testifies to the true genius of the Wrights for accuracy.
In 1902, using their new figures, the brothers designed the most efficient motorless flying machine ever built up to that time. They returned to Kitty Hawk and with it made over 1,000 gliding flights. They continually modified their glider, finally incorporating a movable rudder into their wing warping. This gave them a fully coordinated, three-axial control system. They could now bank and turn, climb and dive at will.
To better understand these two men and their quest, here's a quote from a letter Wilbur wrote home during his early glider tests. He's responding to his family's concern for safety.
If you are looking for perfect safety, you'll do well to sit on a fence and watch the birds. But if you really wish to learn, you must mount a machine and become acquainted with its tricks by actual trial.
In his attempt to allay his family's fears, Wilbert expressed one of the basic principles of flight, namely that it took skill to fly an airplane, just as it took skill to ride a bicycle. This principle, the other early experimenters completely missed.
But as skillful as the brothers were, their lives had actually been saved many times in their early glider flights by a happy accident of design. Their decision to place the horizontal elevators in front of the main wing structure to provide equilibrium.
This not only balanced the machine as the center of air pressure traveled back and forth under the wings, but it also prevented the machine from diving into the ground or spinning whenever it stalled.
It permitted the glider to descend gently to the sand in shallow arcs, almost as if it were being lowered by a parachute. After their highly successful glider flights of 1902, the boys knew they were on the edge of their greatest adventure.
For now, to build a true airplane, it was only necessary to add an engine.
Since no suitable motor was available, The brothers, with their characteristic resourcefulness, designed and built their own. In 6 weeks, they had a small internal combustion engine, weighing about 200 pounds and developing around 12 horsepower. To provide thrust, they fashioned their own propellers, calculating the power loss suffered from two drive chains and shafts. This required a precise determination of propeller efficiency. The magnitude of this problem was later described by Orville. It became more complex the longer we studied it. With the machine moving forward, air flying backward, the propellers turning sidewise, and nothing standing still, it seemed impossible to find a starting point from which to trace the various simultaneous reactions. In determining propeller efficiency through a series of complex quadratic equations, the brothers came within 1% of a propeller's predicted performance. Such analytical accuracy is very difficult to obtain even today. Finally, their new machine, the first airplane in the world with any real chance of success, was finished. Later known as the Kitty Hawk Flyer, it was lovingly packed in crates and accompanied by the excited brothers to their familiar North Carolina testing grounds. Here it was reassembled, and then after almost 2 months of irritating delays, the Kitty Hawk Flyer was ready to go. The first powered flight in the history of the world was made here at the base of Kill Devil Hill on the morning of December 17, 1903. It was made from a position marked by this monument. The Kitty Hawk Flyer skids were placed on a disposable dolly, which rode on the hub of a bicycle wheel and ran along this 60-foot rail, humorously named the Junction Railroad by the brothers. There were four flights that day. The first flight was made by Orville for 120 feet. The second by Wilbur for 175 feet. The third by Orville for 200 feet. And the fourth by Wilbur for a distance of 852 feet in 59 seconds. As we stand by this fourth marker, trying somehow to grasp the true significance of that incredible event, we can look back not only the 852 feet to the starting rail, but through the long corridor of time to that December morning many years ago, and perhaps picture what it was really like. Seconds doesn't sound like much, but it's a long, long time when it's never been done before in the history of the world. That fourth flight validated the other three, taking them out of the category of hops and putting them into the timeless history of fully sustained flight. Today, this original flyer and its notable descendants hang in America's hallowed shrine of flight, the Smithsonian's National Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C. After the triumph of 1903, the next 4 years were to be a bittersweet mixture of success and frustration for the Wrights. Their 1904 airplane was a big improvement over the Kitty Hawk Flyer, better built and with more power. The next spring, Orville and Wilbur moved their test site to a cow pasture near Dayton. However, in their first attempt to fly, the new machine simply couldn't get off the ground. A group of reporters invited to watch the Wrights sail into the air were greatly disappointed and understandably skeptical. It is unlikely that the deeply embarrassed brothers ever fully realized why they failed to fly that day. The answer lay in the vast difference between a cold, windy December 17th at Kitty Hawk and the hot,
calm weather on the 24th of May at Huffman Prairie,
producing an air pressure condition which their underpowered machine could not overcome. To remedy what they perceived to be an acceleration problem, they built a launching mechanism which would provide enough initial thrust for takeoff in the thinner air. A 1,600-pound weight was raised to the top of a tower and released by the pilot. This catapulted the machine forward on the launching rail with sufficient thrust to become airborne. It worked the first time they tried it. The next year, the brothers built an even stronger machine and greatly increased its engine power and endurance. Finally, on October 5th, 1905, Wilbur flew over 38 minutes, circling the field 29 times, flying more than 24 miles at 38 miles an hour.
Only fuel exhaustion kept him from going on.
Then, shockingly, just when they were on the threshold of bringing the world into the aviation age, the brothers stopped flying for 2.5 years. By 1907, they had developed, but not flown, a two-seater airplane with a 38-horsepower engine. They tried first selling it to the U.S. government without success. Then they took it with them to France and stored it while they journeyed all over Europe, trying hard to generate interest in their machine. Ironically, the only individuals interested were steeped in international financial intrigue, a disillusioning experience for the ethical Wrights. Distressed after their futile struggle overseas, the Wrights returned to Dayton that fall. Then things began to happen. Early in 1908, under the prodding of men like Theodore Roosevelt, the U.S. Army Signal Corps agreed to buy an airplane if it could be demonstrated to carry two occupants, a distance of 125 miles, at a speed of 40 miles an hour.
Almost simultaneously, a French syndicate was formed for the express purpose of marketing their flyer in France. This turn of fortune placed the brothers under tremendous pressure. They had not flown in over 2 years.
In May 1908, they returned to their old flying grounds at the foot of Big Kill Devil Hill. With no time to build another airplane, they resorted to a makeshift arrangement, converting their 1905 flyer to new specifications. Because the pilot of their new flyer would need to sit upright, they had to master a whole new actuating system for their controls. Obviously, they had to start flying again immediately.
On May 15th, on a downwind run, Wilbur struck the sand at about 50 miles per hour, cartwheeled and almost totally destroyed the newly constructed flyer. The Wrights were now without an available flying machine, and time for both the U.S. Army and French contracts was running out. The brothers reluctantly split up for the first time in their lives.
Orville returned to Dayton to build a new airplane for the Army requirements at Fort Myer, Virginia. Wilbur, on May 21st, took a steamer for France. He hurriedly searched for a suitable flying field and finally settled on a racetrack outside the medieval town of Le Mans. It was near an empty automobile factory owned by a Frenchman named Leon Bollet, who would become a great friend and supporter. Wilbur had the stored 1907 airplane shipped to the Bollet plant. He found that many parts had been badly damaged during a French customs inspection the year before. Consequently, he faced a first-class rebuilding job. He hired a French mechanic and went to work. Soon the machine was nearly ready for flight.
Earlier, the French press had called the Wrights the bluffers. After all, the paper said, the French were the first balloonists and would be the first to fly airplanes.
Because of the disclosures made in their patent filings and because of details unveiled by Chanute in lectures, several people in France and the U.S. began building rough copies of the Wrights' design. None of them flew with the same degree of success. By the spring of 1908, the competition was stiffening. Furthermore, very few people had actually seen the brothers fly, which added little to their credibility.
Then more misfortune. While Wilbur was running his engine on a test stand, the radiator hose burst, spraying him with scalding water resulting in painful, almost disabling burns.
Just imagine how Wilbur must have felt against such odds. He was still recovering from his burns, exhausted by the burden of working without his brother, in a strange country, surrounded by prominent skeptics, about to fly an airplane that had never been flown before. Not only that, his total powered flight time was less than an hour and 20 minutes, spread over more than 5 years. In the last 2.5 years, he'd flown only 20 minutes, and his last flight had ended in a near-fatal crash.
Such was the atmosphere in which Wilbur, alone in France, found himself.
Finally, in the late afternoon of August the 8th, 1908, everything was ready. A group of about 25 prominent French aviation pioneers came to witness what could very well be the most important flight in history. Several observers were certain that Wilbur's careful preparations would end in disaster. All were skeptical. Everywhere it was said, the Wrights could not fly, but only talk. But Wilbur did fly that day, and he flew splendidly. He was obviously the master of his machine and of his environment.
Of history had been turned. No one had ever seen anything like the flight of Wilbur Wright on August the 8th, 1908.
Even the French press, which before had shown only scorn, now heaped praise upon the brothers. Major B.F.S. Baden-Powell, past president of England's Royal Aeronautical Society, put it more prophetically, that Wilbur Wright is in the possession of a power which controls the fate of nations is beyond dispute. Meanwhile, back in the U.S., Orville began demonstrating his new machine to officials at Fort Myer, setting records almost daily.
Suddenly, tragedy overshadowed triumph.
Orville crashed on the evening of September 17th, 1908, and was critically injured. His passenger, Lieutenant Thomas Selfridge, was killed, the first powered airplane fatality in history. Shocked and saddened, Wilbur brooded a few days, and then took to the air like a man possessed, determined as never before to prove their rightful claim of leading the world into the air. By year's end, he had made many flights, some carrying passengers. Seven lasted for more than an hour, and one of these, on December 31st, flown in a sleet storm, lasted for 2 hours and 20 minutes. The airplane was a practical reality. Early in 1909, Orville, aided by the devoted care of his sister Catherine, was sufficiently recovered to enable both of them to join Wilbur in southern France, where he was running the world's first flying school. There, Catherine took her first airplane ride. To hold her skirts in place, she tied a string around them, which started a new fashion craze, the famous hobble skirt of the Edwardian age. A girl just had to be ready to fly with her bow. Wherever they appeared in Europe, a steady procession of princes, kings, and curious spectators by the thousands came to see Les Hommes Oiseaux, the birdmen. Even the kings of England, Spain, and Italy came to inspect their machine. When it was time to raise the weight on the launching catapult, everyone pitched in. Even Great Britain's former Prime Minister, Arthur James Balfour, the fellow with the deerstalker cap, said anything as important as a man flying is something that a prime minister should get in on. In England, the Wrights were driven around their flying field in a Rolls Royce by none other than Charles S. Rolls himself, who bought one of their planes. President William Howard Taft received them at the White House on their return, and thousands turned out to welcome the heroic brothers home to Dayton. In July of 1909, the Wright flyer flown by Orville met all the qualifications established by the Signal Corps. Soon, several companies abroad were manufacturing the Wright flyers under license. The brothers had not only invented the airplane, they had developed it to a practical form.
Few men have more appreciation of how far flight has evolved and what it means than my good friend Neil Armstrong, who took with him to the moon a piece of the linen fabric of the original Kitty Hawk flyer of 1903.
Throughout all of human history, men have envied the flight of the birds. Perhaps no desire better exemplifies our predilection toward freedom. The Wright's inspiration probably stemmed more from the accomplishments of men, yet they acknowledged the importance of the contributions of the feathered flyers. It's said that history is like a mirror, it can only look back. Undoubtedly true, but there's great value in pausing to look back. For only with appreciation of where we've been can we hope to understand where we're heading.